hand me a pile of TIFF files, a file folder full of them, and tell me that a few of them are going to need modification to make them readable. I'll be very happy. Instruct me that you've fallen upon a directory of PDF files and that they could, in some cases, be duplicates of what I have, but some of them completely unknown to me, and that's my evening. Leave me alone with instructions about how you're going to go through a methodical number of floppy disks or cassette tapes or ROM chips, and you're going to turn them into something that others can use, and I'll be right there for you every step of the way, talking in real time to help you finish the project. Endless, repetitive tasks fascinate me, and they've fascinated me all throughout my life. This is Jason Scott Talks His Way Out of It, a podcast about technology, history, and keeping myself out of debt. Thanks to Jeff Atwood, Daniel Boyd, William Hearn, and the hundreds of other supporters on Patreon and elsewhere who have been supporting me and helping me stay out of debt. In second grade, there was a reading program that they had in place. It was called the Bookworm Program. And what you would do is read a book, some sort of simple picture book or something very simple. But after you finished the book, you would write down the name of it on a bookworm segment, and your bookworm would be put on the wall outside of the classroom. What I remember about this was that over time, segments were being added to the bookworms, and while some students had two or three segments, some had six or seven segments, I had so many segments that my bookworm went to the next classroom down the hallway and actually went around their door. Because I love processing information. All of my life, I've always loved being faced with an enormous amount of input and having to process it, figure it out, maybe collate it, summarize it, or come out with the best of what's there to give to others. Whatever attracts a musically oriented kid to that first piano or instrument, whatever makes somebody comfortable with movement, first get involved with sports or dance, that is what, ultimately, attracted me to computers. At the time, I couldn't understand why everyone wasn't attracted to computers, but looking back now, I can totally see why, seeing typewriters in front of televisions and wondering if there was any use in this whatsoever when there was a wide, beautiful world outside or movies to see or people to talk to. But for me, it seemed perfect. Here was a controllable, powerful machine that could take words, store them, and give them back to me. Where you could give it instructions or take instructions people had given to you from somewhere else you didn't even know where and be able to make this machine do all sorts of fascinating things. It's a magical moment, like mixing together two colors of paint and finding out there's a third one buried in there. It's a moment that changes you. When my father would bring home these very fun toy computers and I played with them, I thought that they were just absolutely magical. My brother and sister, they just didn't see it that way. They might fiddle around with it in the same way that you might fiddle around with an interesting watch or a fun toy or get onto a bike and ride it around, but it wasn't something that compelled them. They didn't go to bed and dream of it. They didn't start cleaving their lives into moments of unconsciousness and then using a computer and then letting their dreams use the computer when they were away from it. That was me. My father put the Commodore PET in the dining room of the house. Our living room didn't have a television. There was a television in his bedroom, but there weren't any other screens anywhere in the house. And the Commodore PET either sat at that formal table or up on its own little table over by the sliding glass door. If I cast my mind back, I can think of sitting there on a small rickety chair, typing away, while feeling the cold radiating in from the window. When I was at my dad's house, I didn't watch television shows, and this was a time when you couldn't record them for later, so I knew I was sacrificing them to oblivion. It was more important to me to type in programs and make the code work, and when Dad switched from a Commodore PET to an IBM PC, especially one that had a modem, there was no other place I wanted to be. And here's the thing. I think he was very enthused at the fact that I took such a liking to this machine, but it also concerned him how much time I wanted to spend on it. Sleep schedules are always very interesting. At the time when I was 12, my father wanted us to go to bed around 10:30 or 11, but I would always find ways to stay up a little bit longer, and he would get tired and go to bed, and he wouldn't really check on me, and then it would get to be 1 or 2 in the morning, and if something woke him up and made him get out of bed and check on me, I could hear him walking through the house, and I knew that yelling was going to come, not because he was angry, but just because he was so concerned about me not getting enough sleep and playing with this thing for hours on end. There was more than one time when he would come and wake up around 6:30 or 7 in the morning and come out and realize that his son had not gotten a wink of sleep. Where do you call it as addiction, and where do you call it as enthusiasm? I look at people like Orson Welles, who would do film editing in a way that at the time seemed indulgent and insane, where he would have multiple film editing machines in different suites up and down a hallway. He would completely take over all of the editing capabilities of the studio he was at, and he would have people working on different scenes and doing different cutting and running them through so he could walk between all of these different rooms, ask to look at something, and then go back to another room where another scene was going on, and then compare them in his mind. All he wanted was nonlinear digital editing. But what he was really doing was absorbing the lives of 5 to 10 assistants trying to make that dream happen in the 1940s. In the same way, I just wanted multiple windows, an endless ability to tell things to download stuff for me, analyze them, and put them back up again. But I didn't have that, so it would have to be one call at a time, looking at things by hand, printing them out, making file names for them, describing those files, and then putting them away into stacks of floppy disks for some sort of later, some sort of library I would eventually build, which I did. How much of my youth, with me running around outside, exploring things, walking up and down streets, getting into trees, getting into scrapes and jumps and yelling and bike riding, how much of that did I throw into the fire just for the ability just to make one more file get downloaded, or get onto a bulletin board system that had been previously busy all night, or to be able to download a file that promised the world to me and which I wanted to see if it lived up to its 128-letter description? Fast forward to the 1980s when I'm running a bulletin board system and I've set it up with all sorts of different software over time, setting up all sorts of different configurations, and for the first time, being capable of having other people call me and leave files with me, to eventually create my own custom BBS software, to fill it up with all sorts of interesting features and add all sorts of weird things to it so that users who came in were blown away with all sorts of bizarre features and me having to constantly bug fix and update and change, you know, turning something which could have been plug-in and making it into an endless tinkering day. Not to mention going through the day's uploads and analyzing them and making sure that the files worked. In some cases, I would have to fix line noise or go in and make changes to the top or the end of the files because it had been obviously clipped off in the wrong place. How many hours did I spend at that? In my first year in college, my father told me that it was a bad idea for me to have a computer at all. So for my freshman year, I didn't have any computer. My Amiga stayed at home. My IBM PC stayed at home. In my sophomore year, I had a small portable PC, so I was mostly calling other bulletin board systems and grabbing files and putting them on floppies, but primarily I was involved in walking around the city of Boston. Maybe for that small amount of time, I lived what some people would have considered to be a normal life, one that wasn't focused around the online world. But it didn't take long for me to discover this thing called the internet, that if I called one number and connected to the right machine with the right guest password, I would suddenly have an infinite amount of things to look for. Once again, I fall into the endless processing, the taking of information out there to understand what this new internet was, this network of network, all these different pieces that were out there, and then figure out how I could save some piece of them for some sort of later. Junior year, I got my Amiga back, and I was back to all my different tricks. I was downloading Amiga programs and playing them and finding demos and playing those. I was typing in programs. I was connecting to other boards and leaving messages. Once again, left with this approach, I ended up with hundreds and hundreds of floppies. Collections of shareware called Fred Fish discs, animations and music and games, and I just wanted them to have them. Hard drives grow bigger, bandwidth increases, 56K, moving to cable modems, moving to Fios, going in to say I want every podcast, going in to say I want to download every site that I can, grabbing every open directory or collection of PDFs and building up these piles of hard drives in my room. Going back to those old floppies, processing them once more and creating textfiles.com, making sure there's descriptions for every file so that people can find it, making a version of the files that's a kind of primer, the Text Files Top 100. All of these things, once again, it's me and information and what feels like the infinite expanse of time and opportunity. Fast forward to now. I'm nearly 50 years old. I own very few books. I read infinite books. I no longer buy hard drives. I have access to hundreds of terabytes of information. Every day gives me a task, a folder, a request, emails asking for help, references to open directories, references to locations and directories that themselves might have come from me in the first place. A legion of associates and fans that care about this information as much as I do and are concerned when it might be lost, and that taking the extra effort to save them and put them somewhere in preparation for a possible coming winter is not weird, but being responsible and forward-thinking. My eyes are failing me. I can hear in the distant horizons of my mind the beginning of forgetting things. Of stuff going monochromatic and then fading, of being unable to bring up to my mind when this program came out or who wrote what or when things happened, and that sense of not being at the forefront and being somewhere in the middle and maybe losing ground. I suppose I could respond with overcompensation, refusing to admit what's going on, not being willing to admit that I'm not the leader and that I'm not necessarily the person who's going to bring us the next phase of things, that maybe my time has passed. I can look back on the life I've lived so far in nearly a half century and decide how much of it did I spend staring at a screen, moving one file to another, how much of this small amount of living pinched between two black infinities have I taken and used the way I have, and was that something that I should have done? But I know, looking back, that the people who I've loved and held, the folks who I've inspired and who have come to me to tell me those stories, and the things that I discovered in those endless, endless nights that lasted until the sunrise, where I took one file, moved it somewhere else, and made a connection that hadn't been there before. All of those nights were golden coins, and I have a dragon's hoard of memories of them. And if these weird machines, these collections of silicon and metal and plastic, have provided me anything at all, it's what feels, in the aggregate, like an unbroken string of paradise. This is Jason Scott Talks His Way Out of It. Thanks to James Bakoyanu, Mark Pilgrim, Adam Green, and the hundreds of other supporters on Patreon and elsewhere who have been helping me stay out of debt.